Thank you so much for the kind introduction, and thanks to the ICTP for the invitation to attend and lecture at this wonderful event. Now, as the very fortuitously, we've actually had two lectures that are relevant. The last one by Don Zygier, and also yesterday's lecture by Michael Berry. So, as you heard in the last lecture, the Jones polynomial is an invariant of a knot that was discovered roughly 30 years ago. It has many connections to mathematical physics that were known since its original discovery. And my goal today is to explain some novel twists on this relationship. But I don't want to assume you all know what is the Jones polynomial, so I'll start with the definition. Of the many possible definitions, I decided on the one I thought I could explain most quickly, which is the vertex model. So here's a knot, and we project it to the plane, which you can think of as the plane of the screen, in such a way that there only are simple crossings like this, and the height function, the vertical function, has only simple local maxima and minima. So I remove finitely many exceptional points, namely all the crossings, minima and maxima, and I label the intervals between crossings by symbol plus or minus 1. And then we sum over labelings with a suitable factor for each crossing. These factors are simple functions of a variable q, which was the same q as in the last lecture. I've left out some local pictures where the weight is 0. But for example, for this kind of picture, with all the labels being plus, we have q to the 1/4. But for this kind of crossing, the weight is 0. So these factors probably look a little bit crazy. You could ask how Jones came up with them. And here are some more crazy factors for local minima and local maxima. Again, everything I haven't written down is 0. So you sum over all possible labelings. You omit all the crossings on the local maxima and minima, leaving finitely many line segments, which you label by symbols plus and minus. And you sum over all labelings with these crazy weights. So you do a finite sum. And it's clear here that the sum is going to be a Laurent polynomial in q to the 1/2. Actually, the q of the last lecture is my q to the 1/2, which is known as the Jones polynomial. Now, the main theorem, which is completely non-obvious in this crazy definition, is that the output of the finite sum does not depend on how the knot was projected to the plane, so the Jones polynomial is a knot invariant. So this knot, which I've projected to the plane one way, we could have projected it to the plane in many other ways, and then we would do this crazy statistical sum, and somehow we'd end up with the same answer. So there are lots of traditional ways to define the Jones polynomial, basically involving mathematical physics. The methods involve statistical mechanics, which we just used, braid group representations, quantum groups, two-dimensional field theory, and more. One thing that was learned in the mid-80s was that something like the Jones polynomial can be defined for every compact Lie group G and every irreducible representation R. The Jones polynomial is the case that the group is SU2 and the representation is the spin a half representation, the two-dimensional representation. So with these clues and some advice from Michael Tia, I found in 1988 a description of the Jones polynomial in terms of three-dimensional gauge theory. So this is a lot like the standard model of particle physics, except we're in three dimensions instead of four, and also the Lagrangian is going to be different. The Lagrangian has to be different because we're trying to make a topological invariant, whereas in the standard model, you're trying to describe propagation of particles. So because we're trying to make a topological invariant, the action has got to be something that we can define with a three-manifold M regarded as an oriented manifold but with no additional structure, no Riemannian metric. We're not allowed to write a standard model action that uses the Riemannian metric. And with nothing but a gauge field A on a Riemannian oriented three-manifold, there's only one gauge invariant thing you can write. There won't really be time to explain it today. Some of you will be familiar with it, some not. Sorry. We're supposed to write something which is the integral of a local expression in the connection and its derivatives. It's also supposed to be gauge invariant, and it's defined with no structure except the orientation. So if you're not already familiar with the Chern-Simons invariant, I won't quite have time to explain why it's gauge invariant, but it's the unique thing we can try to use to write a quantum theory that only depends on M as an oriented 3-manifold. All we really need to know for today is that Chern-Simons, well, it's really almost gauge invariant. It's gauge invariant modulo 2 pi times an integer. It's invariant under gauge transformations that are continuously connected to the identity, but there are what physicists call big gauge transformations, one that can't be reached continuously from the identity, and they will shift the value by 2 pi times the integer. Now, Feynman told us what we're supposed to do is to take the action and exponentiate it, multiplied by the square root of minus 1, which I call I, and then integrate over all possible fields. And in the case of gauge theory, Fadeyev and Popov say we have to also divide by the volume of the gauge group. So, and then we're supposed to put here, usually, 1 over Planck's constant. But instead of 1 over Planck's constant, I've put an integer k. And the reason I put an integer k is that, as I told you, the Chern-Simons function is only gauge invariant modulo 2 pi. So for this procedure to make sense, k has to be an integer, so that although the action is not gauge invariant, its exponential times I will be gauge invariant. So this is a construction that only makes sense when k is an integer. And then this Feynman integral is defined with no structure on M except an orientation, so it's an invariant of an oriented 3-manifold M. Well, I'm hiding some details, which we won't have time to explain. Now, if we want to include a knot, what's the basic invariant of a gauge field when you have a knot? Well, mathematicians call it the holonomy of the gauge field around the knot. Physicists in this context call it the Wilson operator, and usually write the holonomy this way. Sorry, we take the holonomy, but then we take its trace in a given representation to get the Wilson operator. So we do the same thing which we did before. We have the same Feynman integral of the exponential of the action. We now include an extra factor of the Wilson operator. And now, formally, this depends on nothing except the oriented 3-manifold M with an oriented knot in it. So it should be an invariant of that pair. Now, if we specialize to the case that our 3-manifold is just R3, and we take SU2 and the 2-dimensional representation, then it turns out that this Feynman integral gives the Jones polynomial evaluated at a root of unity that depends on k. We don't get all the roots of unity that we heard about in the last lecture. We only get certain primitive k plus 2th roots of unity. Now, this is only a discrete set of values of q, but of course these values are enough to determine a Laurent polynomial. So this is a way of looking at the Jones polynomial, which in the context of quantum field theory. So the argument that this invariant is related to the Jones polynomial involved making contact with conformal field theory, with two-dimensional conformal field theory. So in this game, there's a link between gauge theory in 3 dimensions and conformal field theory in 2 dimensions. And that link has a lot of applications, which we don't have time to talk about very much today. But it's important in condensed matter physics in the study of where it was discovered independently, I should say, in the study of the quantum Hall effect and related phenomena. In fact, I think that the main reason for physicists being familiar with this link between 3 dimensions and 2 is its role in the quantum Hall effect. And then this has generalizations to fractional quantum Hall systems. So what do we get with this approach to the Jones polynomial? As I said at the beginning, there are many known approaches to the Jones polynomial. The vertex model I told you about, quantum groups, braid group representations, and a lot of others. What do we get from this particular approach? Well, it actually has more or less the opposite advantages and disadvantages of any other approach. So the advantage it has is that it gives a manifest topological invariant, not depending on a knot projection or other structure. One isn't checking generators and relations. One simply directly defines a topological invariant. The disadvantage that comes with it is that it's not obvious at first why we will be able to calculate. And to explain why we can calculate involves explaining why this approach is related to one of the other approaches. Despite its manifest topological invariance, there were at least two things many knot theorists didn't like about it. The first was simply that quantum field theory is difficult to understand mathematically, although it's the bread and butter in relativistic particle physics and much of condensed matter physics. The second issue was that this does not give a direct explanation of why the Jones polynomial is naturally understood as a function of a complex variable q rather than just an integer variable k. So most other approaches to the Jones polynomial don't obviously give a topological invariant, but they do obviously give a Laurent polynomial. Now, there's actually a subtlety here, which is that for most three manifolds, the answer that comes from the gauge theory is the right one. So if we're on a generic three manifold, so for knots in R3, the natural variable is this complex variable, Q. But on a general three manifold, the quantum knot invariants depend only on the integer K and don't have natural continuations to functions of Q without losing some three-dimensional symmetry. So the gauge theory gave the right answer generically, but some special things happen for knots in R3. And 25 years ago, I actually accepted that Wilson operators in R3 are special and that things happen there that you don't naturally see from the gauge theory. But some things happened more recently involving the volume conjecture that was mentioned in the last talk and also Kovanoff homology that we won't have time for today that made me take another look and try to get a new explanation from gauge theory of what was going on in R3 that's special. But time is short, so I won't explain the motivation, and I'll just try to describe the answer I arrived at. But before telling you what I did, we'll consider a few issues about the allowed values of K from the point of view of condensed matter physics. So here we could consider exotic materials like quantum Hall systems, but for brevity, we'll just consider the simplest possible materials, materials that have no relevant degrees of freedom, not even topological ones, so that in particular, the only gauge, so these materials would be completely inert. In particular, the only gauge field of interest will be the U1 of electromagnetism. So first we consider an abstract two-dimensional material floating in empty space. It could be an atomic or molecular monolayer. Actually, nowadays, a monolayer of graphene would be an interesting example. But it could also be a sheet of paper. What I'll say applies to a sheet of paper. The only trouble is that it'll be trivial. The invariant we define will be zero for a sheet of paper. So any material which is inert and has two dimensions very large compared to its thickness will do. So a sheet of paper large compared to its thickness is fine. So the hypothesis basically meant it's an insulator. So a sheet of paper is an insulator, and it's a perfectly good example, but a more interesting example turns out to be a monolayer of graphene. The effective action for its interaction with the electromagnetic field, potential, can have all kinds of conventional terms that describe polarizability, susceptibility, and so on. All these terms would have analogs in a fully three-dimensional material. What we get from having a two-dimensional material is that one more term is possible. You have to remember that we should include time in describing this material. So if, as a spatial material, it's two-dimensional, its world volume in space-time is three-dimensional, counting time, and therefore we can write this Chern-Simons interaction, which I've written in a slightly different way from before in the case of the electromagnetic gauge field. There's no trace because we're simply doing electromagnetism. Now, as I've explained, this interaction is only gauge invariant mod 2 pi if k is an integer. So we conclude that two-dimensional materials that are inert, they're conductors, sorry, they're insulators in a very strong sense, are characterized by an integer k. And this k is essentially the coefficient of the whole current. So this gives an explanation, not a new explanation at all, an attractive and familiar but slightly abstract explanation for why the whole current is quantized in any two-dimensional material that obeys our assumptions. There's a more contemporary twist on that tale that involves topological insulators. So we're now going to consider a two-dimensional surface that's not freely floating in empty space. Instead, it's going to be the boundary of a fully three-dimensional material. Then the answer is completely different, and any value of k at all is possible. So now, well, unfortunately, it's hard to tell from the picture whether that's an abstract a monolayer that's been carved into a sphere, or the boundary of a three-dimensional material. But you're supposed to think of this as the boundary of a three-dimensional material. So before saying physically what's going on, I'll just state the underlying mathematical effect. If A is a U1 gauge field on a three-manifold W, and we want to define the Chern-Simons function as a gauge invariant real number, we're actually out of luck. It's only defined mod 2 pi. But if we're given a four-manifold M with boundary W, and we're given a way of extending A over M with gauge invariant field strength F, there's no problem. We replace I with the corresponding Pontryagin integral over the four-manifold I hat. The point is that I hat is manifestly gauge invariant and well-defined as a real number, and equals I mod 2 pi. So the only trouble with this as the definition of I is that it depends on the choice of M and the extension of the gauge field. But if M is physical, that's no problem. So since I hat is completely gauge invariant, a term k times I hat is possible for any real k. And since this is the same as ki, this means that the surface of an insulating material, even if we assume that the bulk and the surface are completely gapped with no relevant degrees of freedom, can have Hall currents with an arbitrary coefficient. Moreover, we should expect this coefficient to be non-zero unless there's a symmetry that explains why it would be zero. So, K hasn't been measured, but it might be measured in principle by scattering light from the surface. It's certainly a measurement that people talk about trying to do. Here I was explaining that, there's a variant of this that's more famous, actually, that has when the boundary violates our assumptions, but there isn't time to explain it now. So with this inspiration, we go back to the Chern-Simons gauge theory of, say, SU2, if we're trying to describe the Jones polynomial, where the action was this one, and the integral was over a three-manifold that I wish I had called it W, because when I went to condensed matter physics, the three-manifold was W. But unfortunately, there's a slight mismatch in notation. Now the three-manifold is M. So if M is a bare three-manifold, then as I've told you, a bare three-manifold means an oriented three-manifold, no more structure is given. As I've told you, K has to be an integer if you want the action to be gauge invariant mod 2 pi. To get away from that, we don't want M to be a bare three-manifold. Instead, we'll take M to be the boundary of a four-manifold X, and we'll assume we're actually trying to define a topological quantum field theory on a four-manifold X whose boundary is M. This changes the problem, which is no longer to explain why K doesn't have to be an integer, but rather to explain how to get anything interesting on a four-manifold with boundary. So step one isn't a problem because of the same identity that we used in the condensed matter problem. The naive action, once M is given as the boundary of a four-manifold, can be defined as a real number. And therefore, K has no reason to be an integer. The problem is instead to explain what topological field theory we want to use on the four-manifold X that will somehow be related to Chern-Simons theory on the boundary when X has a boundary. I put quotes about the word identity because the right-hand side is a real number and the left-hand side is only defined mod 2 pi. So the identity is not so much an identity as an improved definition of the left-hand side. With the help of this identity, there's no problem with getting away from integer k. The problem is problem two, to define a topological quantum field theory on a four-manifold with boundary. Assuming we don't succeed, we won't get a three-dimensional topological quantum field theory because the choice of x in general breaks some of the symmetry of m. So for those hyperbolic three-manifolds that were in the last lecture, there won't really be a natural choice of x. But knots are an exception. You can embed a knot in a 3C or S3. Without it breaking any symmetries, you can consider S3 as the boundary of a four-ball. And therefore, for the special case of the knots in S3, we don't lose any symmetry by this procedure. And so, if we can find the right four-dimensional topological quantum field theory, we'll get a satisfactory definition for why the knot invariants, but not the more general quantum invariants, are not limited to integer k. The hard part is definitely to find the right four-dimensional field theory. And here I only have time for a few hints, and I don't really have enough time for them. But I'll try to give you a couple of hints. First of all, the reason the problem is hard is we don't get anywhere if we try to take this the right-hand side of this formula as a four-dimensional action. That won't work because although it's certainly a topological invariant, it doesn't use a metric on x, it's degenerate. If you try to use this as an action, you'll find that the kinetic energy is zero. The operator, the elliptic, actually vanishes. And at first sight, there's no way to remove the degeneracy without adding terms that do depend on a metric on x. So we need to know something about where topological quantum field theories come from. In condensed matter physics, they usually arise because there are no local degrees of freedom. The material is inert, like that sheet of paper we discussed. But there's another source of topological quantum field theories. They arise by focusing on a selected class of questions and more physical ones. I'll try to just say this one sentence. Starting with a supersymmetric field theory, you pick a supercharge whose square is zero, and then you consider special questions. You only consider Q invariant questions, modular trivial ones, and then you get a topological field theory. What you get this way is usually called a twisted version of the original theory, and what I found here was that a twisted version of the same supersymmetric theory that, for example, John Schwartz talked about yesterday, gives a quantum field theory that's related to Chern-Simons on the boundary. So one can think of this as a four-manifold theorist version or a knot theorist version of the statement that a Hall current with an arbitrary coefficient can flow on the surface of a three-dimensional material. So the three-dimensional material has got to be described by this twisted version of n=4 super Yang-Mills theory, and then it's related to Chern-Simons theory on the boundary, now not with k necessarily being an integer. Now, I just want to give a hint about the procedure for going from three to four dimensions. For motivation, I'll just say that there's another obvious problem with analytic continuation in k, which is that we were dealing with an oscillatory integral, but if we give k an imaginary part, the Feynman integral was exponentially divergent. But we heard yesterday about what to do about it. So yesterday we heard about the Airy function, which is given by this integral. And if you want to, it's an oscillatory integral for real k, but if you want to continue it to complex k, which was essentially part of yesterday's lecture by Michael Berry, we know what to do. You analytically continue the integrand from real x to complex x, and then you improve it by picking a different contour on the complex plane. You continue from real to complex x, and you find a better contour on the complex plane so that the integral remains convergent even if k is not real. Here's another quick example. This is an integral that defines a Bessel function. It's an integral on the unit circle. And the reason k has to be an integer if you want to solve Bessel's equation, because when you prove Bessel's equation, you integrate by parts. And if k is not an integer, the integrand isn't single-valued, and you pick up a surface term. So naively, k is an integer. But what if you want to solve Bessel's equation when k isn't an integer? Well, the procedure was discovered in the 19th century. First, you analytically continue into the complex plane, replacing theta by e to the I theta, which we call z. And now here's the integral we're trying to do. And at the moment, k still has to be an integer, but to get away from integer k, we change the integration cycle, or contour, to one that looks like this. Instead of integrating on the unit circle, we add these tails, which are chosen so that they cancel if k is an integer, but they will not cancel if k is not an integer. If the real part of n is positive, the integral is exponentially convergent on these tails. And so we get a solution of Bessel's equation as a function of n, as long as the real part of n is positive for any k. The new integral coincides with the old one if k is an integer, since the extra bits that have been added cancel when k is an integer. So that's how the Bessel's function is continued away from integer k, assuming you started with this definition of the Bessel equation, where it looks like k has to be an integer. So I just imitated that for Chern-Simons gauge theory. I complexified the space of fields, and I looked for a better integration cycle. And a better integration cycle was supposed to have two properties. The path integral converges, and the integral over the new cycle makes sense for any k, not necessarily an integer. So I won't explain how I did that. I'll just say that there's an answer where you take the integration cycle to consist of fields that are boundary values of solutions of a certain system of four-dimensional equations. So if you're trying to do a topological field theory on W, which has sometimes been called M, you pick to find a new integration cycle, you pick a four-dimensional X whose boundary is W, and then you integrate over fields on W, which are boundary values of solutions on X of a certain system of elliptic PDEs that I won't write down. But the equations that work arise in N equals 4 Supriang-Mills, and the physical meaning is that there's a twisted version of N equals 4 on a 4 manifold that's equivalent to Chern-Simons on the boundary. Or more exactly, it's equivalent to an analytically continued version of Chern-Simons where k doesn't have to be an integer. And one, I'll just conclude with this last slide. Once we get this far, we know a lot about four-dimensional Supriang-Mills theory. It has electromagnetic dualities and also stringy T dualities come into play. So you can learn a lot more, but we'll have to leave that for another occasion. Thank you.
Because my eyesight fails me, so he will take the questions. I think we have time for two questions at least.
Quick questions.
We know that Chern-Simons are related to conformal field theory, which is even another dimension.
Yes.
So for arbitrary kappa, what are the conformal field theory?
Well, the questions about analytic continuation make sense also in two dimensions. Because, for example, the braid group representations are defined for arbitrary Q. But if you go to a higher genus Riemann surface, Q should be a root of unity. So what I said about continuing away from Q has an analog in two dimensions. But what I'd like to say as a comment is that, you see, the story of the, let's say, 25 years ago is a relation between three and two dimensions. Now I'm describing to you a relation between three and four dimensions. So there's really a hierarchy of theories in dimensions two, three, and four. And I can't promise that the relation between three and four is as interesting and significant as the one between two and three, but it would be nice if that turns out to be true.
In the dictionary of this talk that you have developed, how can you speak of the Kovanov homology?
There isn't time to get to Kovanov homology. I'll just say that getting from three to four dimensions, I would say, was the hard part. Getting from what I've told you today to Kovanov homology involves standard applications of standard S-duality and T-duality, but there isn't time to explain it.